I'm Philip Bither, the curator for performing arts here at the Walker Arts Center, and this is Elizabeth Streb, who is a choreographer and a movement creator. And we are in about 8 days into a 12-day residency.
Yeah.
And this is Elizabeth is here developing two new works that have been commissioned by the Walker with funds from the National Dance Project. There may be other commissioners involved in these works as well, but
I'm sure there are.
There's many these days.
Many these days.
And just yesterday and the day before, there was your work was seen at the Twins, the Minnesota Twins professional baseball game at the Metrodome. And I thought we'd start, before we just get into that experience, with talking a little bit about your background and just briefly how you got to this point from what started as something of at least a fairly traditional dance training, and what was the, as I should say, jumping off point for you away from that training, and just kind of bring us up to date quickly from there.
My formal training actually started in SUNY Brockport in the university, where I got a degree, a Bachelor of Science degree in modern dance in 1972. That was sort of an accidental kind of segue of events, because I was going to originally be a PE teacher, and had it been possible to be probably a pro ball player, basketball or baseball, that's what my avocation was. But I also had done a lot of painting and drawing, mm-hmm. all the way from early grammar school on.
Right.
I was the one for the nuns that made the Christmas cards huge on the posters for the bulletin board, so I had a real ability to draw,
right.
that kind of skill. And so I was always going into Rochester to take art classes at the art gallery there. And I think that I saw myself, I guess, because of that experience, as part artist, part athlete. And dance seemed to be the perfect intersection of those two passions, I thought. But that was, it was based in a conceit that was pretty uninformed. I had no idea what dance was. I didn't even know what a plié was. The other part of the reason why I thought I'd be a good dancer was, you know how high school kids, you go to the disco, and every few months there's a new rhythm, a new dance.
Yeah.
And I was really good at picking up the rhythm. So. Over at one of my friends, high school friend's house, we'd have a party, and I'd teach them the new dance. Because they couldn't figure out how to deconstruct the rhythm to make to look cool doing it. And it was really not cool unless you could do the new rhythm disco dance, whatever it was. That was in the late 60s. So when I went to major in dance, I went to the chairperson of the department, which was Rose Strasser at the time at Brockport, and said, you know, I'm really in shape because I'm done downhill skiing, motorcycle riding, and basketball and baseball, and also I pick up rhythms really easy. And do you think that will have any influence on me being able to major in dance? She, oh, absolutely not. That has nothing to do with it. I was like, oh, well. And then she asked me, I think,
that
to
was
touch
the start
me.
Of your realization that you may not be right in the dance world.
I don't fit here somehow. But I went ahead, you know, and went through 4 years training as a dancer, had a lot of respect for the field. Wasn't lit on fire by training in that way, but I felt it was important to go ahead and acquire a technique and be diligent about it before I started to throw it away. I think I was just kind of lost in the activity and the rigor of gaining a technique.
Right.
And when I graduated, I went to San Francisco.
Dance with Margaret Jenkins?
Dance with Margaret Jenkins for a couple years, studied there, made a couple dances there, showed them in showcases, solos, mostly working on a pretty emotional departure point physically, because I was trained in college in Humphrey, Weidman, and Limon technique. Mm-hmm. Susanna Payton and Jim Payton were the resident company who actually got imported from Ohio State and were there the whole 4 years. Very sophisticated, very, very... kind of amazing teachers and really devoted
in
to the
San
students.
Yeah.
No, they were in SUNY Brockport, where I went to college.
I see. Right.
And at SUNY Brockport at that time, there were lots of New York professors there.
Right.
So we saw everyone from Elwin Nicolai to Paul Taylor to Jamie Cunningham. Mm. Daniel Nagrin was there for a lot of the time.
Really?
And was one of my big influences.
Oh, really?
Yes.
He just left here as a residency two
did he really?
Week ago or 2 weeks
wow.
ago.
Well, he was just a dramatic influence on me. And so anyway, after maybe 2 years in San Francisco, I moved to New York City. And that was in 1974. And I started showing work in New York in probably 76 and continued from there, mostly Cunningham-based, because after I left college, I trained in all Cunningham technique. Mm. Viola Farber was my teacher in New York, and I always took one modern class and one ballet class every day for 20 years, so.
Did you find yourself attracted to Cunningham in particular because of his similar interest to strip dance away from its from much that surrounds it often and really focus on the movement itself, for itself.
I think, yes. I think that I like the intellectual behind of the Cunningham aesthetic.
Right.
It was fairly, in terms of vocabulary, balletically based, but I felt like it's the only rigorous training that can exist, and I didn't want to take quality-oriented training programs, like
right.
what I felt about Eric Hawkins or Limone or Contact Improv was really not about training the bones and the muscles. It was more qualitative training, mm-hmm. which I felt could come later.
Right.
Like the how of doing things was not so much a concern to me as, you know, getting the muscles strong and being able to stand up on your feet and
right.
do tricky moves.
Both Merce and before his death, I mean, several years before John Cage, have admired your work, and in particular, Cage was quoted as saying, mostly I find the art of dance disgusting for physical, emotional, or even political reasons. But and he went on to praise your work. Would you say that that summarizes your feeling about much of dance that you see today?
Or I don't know.
Or do you see yourself really separate from, really standing apart from the bulk of contemporary choreography and dance that's happening right now?
Well, I mean, I don't know how close, if you're going to put people on a scale, like how close I would stand next to the rest of the people in terms of their concerns.
Right.
Artistic concerns approaching their ideas, which I think all work ends up being.
Right.
About ideas and form and function. But I think that for me, I've looked at dance, which I think every artist has to do within their discipline,
sure.
to say whatever it is, words, language,
music,
film,
right.
music, and say, you know, what is the nature of this idea? Well, how does it exist in the world? And try and figure out what is movement. And the way I've analyzed, or how can it most powerfully propel itself as a language?
Mm-hmm.
And the way I've analyzed also the way dance tends to do that, I don't agree with. You know, it's basically about me analyzing it formally and deciding
right.
The three things I think dance does, which is one, deal with music, associate itself
right.
rhythmically and structurally with music. I completely disagree with that. And I've always said music is a true enemy of dance because oral systems of composition and physical systems are antithetical compositionally and technically in terms of building parts from one another. And the other thing I think dance does is attempt to express emotion as
right.
a starting off point. I don't believe movement as a starting off point does that well. I think it's an emergent
right.
Function of movement, that it does ultimately express emotion. But if you start with saying, I'm going to make a dance about how I feel or what happened, I don't think movement lends itself to that without parody
right.
seeping in.
Right.
And
Artifice.
And right. and then the other thing I think is about demonstrating relationships between individuals, which I think exists also as an emergent property,
right.
but not as an initial idea. To me, it's really about movement does itself best. And I believe that if you do a real move in as pure a way as you can do it, it will do all those other things and much more powerfully.
It will reflect its own musicality. It will have its own emotionalism, things like that.
Exactly.
If it's brought to its purest state.
Yes, yes.
One of the things I find interesting, I mean, that of the many things, in your work, you also are okay with showing the rigor, and sometimes even showing, you know, showing the difficulty and even sometimes the mistakes that happen in trying to find that pure movement. That's an intention.
In terms of showing the effort.
Yeah.
Or more, I think accurately, not camouflaging gravity or the effect of gravity.
Right.
Really. And I do believe that, again, it's all about trying to bring a real move into a stage, which is an artificial situation,
right,
without debilitating it. And to me, doing an artificial move is tantamount to kind of lying, not being honest with your form, sort of. That's how
I
made the
analogy. Can you describe a real move?
But that's hard to do.
Yeah.
That's a great question, but it's hard to do because a real move would be, if I analyzed action in the world, like, for instance, a tornado or any kind of turbulence,
right,
styrofoam in the wind.
Right.
The way animals move, I think, is honest. Often the way children move. The way a tin can rolls in the subway car. Inanimate objects can't lie when they move.
Right.
They're subject to the forces of gravity and the laws
physics.
Of Newton.
Right.
I believe humans physically live in their own cliche-ridden universe, and when they go ahead and make a physical, or I mean an intellectual decision about how to move, it falls apart immediately. So a real move would be me encompassing action as it exists in the universe. And my question is, can a body survive that kind of intensity? I'm not sure it can. My effort is to attempt to do that. And that's one of the reasons we try and deal with the invisible forces of action, which are those forces that cause movement to happen, but that are invisible. And if we can, we've been attempting to physically harness each one of them individually, like impact, like rebound,
right,
like centrifugal force, which this new piece, Fly
yeah,
will show pretty seriously. But a real move is really all of those things. It's really what happens in a hurricane. It's what happens
right
when someone stumbles.
Right.
And I think it's one of the most incredibly complicated things to demonstrate on stage. But to me, to camouflage gravity would be the opposite approach of how to do that.
Right. When in a piece like Bounce, the artists, your dancers are, reach that height point before they start descending. I mean, that trajectory, I mean, the whole thing, while it doesn't begin as a pure move because they're forcing themselves to do that jump,
right,
then they let themselves be at sort of the mercy of those forces. Is that where you get to the pure movement point, would you say? Or
ideally, that's what my hope is, that everything that falls or flies exists pathwise in a parabolic curve.
Right.
There's no way to dismiss the parabola. So there's always an apex, a dead
right
time, a high point.
Right.
And there's always an arrival and a departure and a return. And the reason, I mean, the fact that gravity is sucking your body down at 32 feet per second squared, which is tremendous force, really.
Right.
The only way that exercises itself is when you're off the vertical plane. So to me, going in and out of that situation, in and out of the fall line of the earth, is a way to really show little tiny explosions. And we train our body.
Explosions against gravity, basically, or explosions?
I think the explosions happen when you reunite with with the source
with
of gravity,
or,
with surface. Yeah, any kind of surface, or each other,
right,
when bodies hit in the air.
Right.
And abruptly and almost dramatically stop each other.
Right.
That explosion, to me, is a function, an aftermath of action, every explosion. And the piece I did actually in New York recently, the breakthrough,
right,
the single movement moment,
right,
which is diving through a plate of glass, is really along the idea that I'm trying to develop more pieces of that idea, which is to show the effect of action on substance. Because you really, everything is abstract if you're just moving in a smooth looking universe.
Right.
But when you hit each other or the ground or a substance, then you see a little bit more information about action.
So by the choice of the substance of glass, more than just the sensational and kind of dramatic theatrical quality of it, it actually was a substance that allows you to show the result of a certain action.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. Which therein to me lies more information than I feel I've ever really been able to affect. And, you know, in the end, I'm intellectually organizing these moves.
Uh-huh.
I usually choreograph and make hundreds of seconds of motion that exist separately. Hmm. And then I end up organizing them. And that is, you know, a human intellectual process. So I can't choreograph that exploding glass.
Right.
And that's what I'm trying to do in all of my work, is to have one of those real moments happen.
Right. But your works are also, when you said you choreograph lots of seconds, your works also exist in a more formal, you know, structured sense. I mean, those pieces come together as a whole to create a, it seems to me, you know, there's obviously a shape of each work that you've created, more than just the exploration of the one movement. There's actually a layering and an order, a choreography, obviously, to it all beyond the individual pieces. How do you get at that? I mean,
yeah, that's true. That ends up, I guess,
or maybe it's not true. But it's, I mean, it's obviously seems to me to be very much shaped in, I mean, in the sense that you're exploring that movement through a series of sequences that are put together.
Right. Right, and all the pieces are slightly different, even though they are still my work.
Right.
I'm one person. You know, in one person, I mean, I guess one person's voice, you try as hard as you can to cover the waterfront.
Right.
But in the end, you know, you're just this one lonely person,
right,
like fudging around in your brain to try and like stretch it. So I think that for me, what we've been talking about has been a lot about physical properties and a little bit about invisible forces, but I also have temporal issues,
right,
and spatial issues that go into the mix.
Mm-hmm.
And usually, though, I start with where I want to be in space, and where I haven't has to do making that choice has to do with where I haven't been spatially.
Right.
And to me, it's an increasingly complicated idea, space, especially. And I try and analyze that formally as well as I do temporality.
Uh-huh.
And timing and temporality, it remains the most complex, mysterious element of what I do. And I usually divide what I do into three parts, like physical, human movement potential,
right,
time and space. And all the rest are subsets of that. Because I know formally in dance training there's about six different elements of dance, but I whittled it down to three main ones. So that when I go ahead and make all these parts, once I've established a spatial paradigm,
right,
what I'm really trying to do is to dimensionalize the experience of action, you know, and to create an intricate structure that will not leave parts out, given the idea. If the idea is substantive enough, then I'm able to go in there and create, hopefully, a universe that basically has a picture that's turning all the time. That's because I'm usually in a situation like this where you have frontal viewing.
Right.
I'm always aware that's how it's going to be seen.
Mm-hmm.
And so the order of the parts, what my decisions, in reference to your question, have to do with what's the rhythm. Once all those other parts get put together, once we invent vocabulary and the technique, which always has to be reinvented for every new spatial situation we set up, there's usually a new vocabulary that emerges a little bit, which is very time-consuming.
I was going to say, I mean, unlike other forms of dance, it would to have to recreate a part of your a new vocabulary for each piece must take a long time to develop works. Then
it does. It does. I mean, longer than assembling steps that come from a vocabulary that are already established.
Right.
This is about new moves, always trying to make up new moves and to create a situation that forces you to do that. And it's time consuming and expensive.
Right.
And it seems to get more expensive as time gets more expensive.
Right.
As life goes forward, right?
Life's own temporal problem.
Right. I don't know why that is. I used to once have a belief that if my budget was never going to get above $100,000.
Your
which
own,
seemed like a
your
huge
company's
amount.
Budget.
Just my operational budget.
Right.
Everything. Yeah. 100,000. Because I, and in a way, as naive as I was then, that is a really good idea.
Right.
I think it's kind of impossible
yeah.
to exist for 20 years and keep it there, but that's really the healthy artistic zone financially. But
I was going to ask, do you find that frustrating to be now at a level of operation where you do have to not only you do have to be involved in a lot of financial oversight, larger, you know, management of a sort of operation in a certain way, but even maybe even this other issue of that we were talking about before the camera started was developing your works for tour, where you can't just purely be thinking conceptually, you have to also be thinking logistically and how the works go out on the tour. In some ways that seems almost like that gives you another challenge, another kind of the way you work with space or a confined environment. This is another form of confined environment in a certain way, that you have to, the restrictions of stage work and proscenium space and theaters that probably won't have more than 25 feet of depth and that sort of thing. Do you like the challenge, or do you miss the ability to kind of function in a freer way and develop the work without those constraints?
I mean, I guess I don't really believe in freedom that it exists anywhere. And to me, I kind of welcome any kind of constrictive edge because that's just the way it is.
Right.
You know, I don't know who has the privilege to have all the time in the world to make work,
right.
all the space in the world to make it, and all the money. And to me, I respect those constraints.
Right.
And I try to use them as creatively as the rest of the problems I set for myself.
Right.
The world sets those for me, and I embrace them
right.
as realistic, you know. And I don't find it, it's just the way it is, and
right.
I don't get hampered by it.
Yeah.
I mean, we have a studio in Brooklyn where we work now that has 13-foot ceilings, and most of my work could use a 20-foot ceiling space,
right.
but it's too expensive.
Right.
And so, but we have a great space, and I kind of love rehearsing there and then having to do an adjustment height-wise when we get to where we're going.
Right.
And we've learned how to do that. You know, that was a variable that I wasn't sure we could do.
Right.
But it was what we had to do to have a laboratory full-time in New York, a movement laboratory. Otherwise, we're renting $3,000 spaces for a week.
Sure, right.
And
right.
working like hit and run.
Yeah, and not being able to have a consistency of.
Yeah. So everything has to do with, you know, we're. But just going skipping back a little, just
yeah,
to the
sure.
final, the issue of making putting everything together.
Right.
I was going to say that it's about the rhythm. Ultimately, after all is said and done, when I think a piece is effective, or when I notice that it is, and only I can only really tell that after I've performed it a number of times. It has to do with what's the rhythm. And the rhythm comes out of every other decision that I've made. And to me, it's about setting archetypal junctures of space and time that resonate or are recognized in the kind of psyche entirety of a human being. And I feel like it's like target practice, that there do exist these kind of crossover junctures of time and space that are universally recognized, like you know, certain like beautifully harmonious sounds that
right.
move people when they hear it.
Right.
My real goal is to figure out what are those points in time and physical position and space that are provocative on a level that is recognizable almost digitally in the human being. Not literally or narratively, or gee, that's the story about me when I was on my porch and the Southern Tier 20
right.
years ago.
Right.
But it might bring up things that people don't even know are in there.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm going for. That's why I believe action is the most powerful art form, ultimately.
I think either you or some journalist said that it's like the residue, that the nature of the work connects to the residue of physical events that lie in our nerves. I mean, that it's sort of really deep in there, that it's not a conscious, it's not a cerebral sort of reading necessarily, that it's both that, but it's also a very physical kind of response that people yeah. have if you get the rhythm right.
If you get the rhythm right, which is why it was so exciting to perform in the Metrodome.
Right.
Because I wanted to see how does this read here
right.
to this conglomeration of people that we don't know,
yeah,
but that are coming here for a baseball game.
Right.
And it's really important to me because I feel like I used to, for 20 years in New York, be really interested in the high art world and, mm-hmm. you know, do they think this is important? And I mean, of course, you're forced to think, to want, sure. to care about that.
Right.
And I do care about that, obviously. But now I care about all these other things.
Hmm.
Like, could I go to a mall and perform this? And would people
and
walk away?
Right.
And I mean,
right.
What, that came up once for me early on, late 80s, for Dancing in the Streets, they'd present events
sure.
on Coney Island on the boardwalk. And that was the first time I was like, oh, you don't have like a kind of trapped audience.
Right, right. They haven't
they
spent
don't
their
like
15
you,
bucks.
They have not. And if they don't like you, they're going to walk down
right.
to the sideshow
right.
and see some real moments. You know?
Right.
So I was really interested in noticing that then and continue to be.
Hmm. Well, there's that you know, your work works both on a very accessible and a kind of... I mean, you even term your work as pop action in a sort of pop way, but it also has a sort of an intellectual foundation that seems to be able to speak to people on many levels. And mm-hmm. do you find that balance, that tightrope, difficult to walk? I mean, we were having this conversation last night about art versus entertainment, and I find the most interesting work often is one that can function in both realms. Do you often find it difficult to keep that balance, or that you'll create a work that you love intellectually, but it doesn't work to keep a general audience's attention or anything?
I mean, I have a lot of those works in my repertory.
Right.
You know, that are really idiosyncratic
uh-huh.
and were happened in the 80s and even early 90s that I'm in love with, but I think all are about the deep digging concepts about minutiae.
Right.
In human movement and human position and the deconstruction of the human body in space. And I could go wild there.
Right.
But I don't do that because it doesn't read in the same way.
Hmm.
And I do want to go to that other place right now where, mm-hmm. There's only 24 hours in every day.
Right.
So I feel like I can do everything. I can have that in the work, which I think I do. And I think a lot of that I learned from John Cage and Merce Cunningham.
Hmm.
Their enormous rigor in presenting a non-personality-driven structure to
right.
work from.
Right.
A methodology that allows you to believe that it's not a cold kind of disparate world you approach when you deal structurally or formally with inventing work. But that the idea of circumventing the personality is ultimately respectful to your form and to yourself. You know, I don't
right.
want to be privy to my whims and my moods
right.
and my personality and what I only know. Only I know this, which is so limited. So I do develop formal structures when I approach work.
Right.
And I am not satisfied with how I feel or what I think about it.
Right.
I try and... present a situation that will force me into a topography that is foreign to me, that I need to learn about,
hmm.
that I need to study, and it will continually inform me. And it operates, you know, on a premise that I know this much about the world of movement, and there's infinity.
Right, right.
And I'm not staying here.
Right.
Because I'll get bored.
Right.
So I think that a lot of that intellectual attachment and attack to work comes from them, and probably Duchamp and the Dada school and all of that. And I think when people look at it kind of askance, I think they don't understand that the beauty of how every time you go to a Merce Cunningham concert, there is invention there.
Hmm.
It's not the same
right.
thing. He is constantly pushing.
Right.
And once I heard him say it's just about walking through the world and being curious. It's not any more complicated than that.
Hmm.
And curiosity to me implies that you agree that you don't know everything, and even that what you know is just not sufficient to
right.
even approach a new piece.
Hmm.
It's just not sufficient. It was only sufficient for what you've done.
For the last piece or
right.
whatever, yeah.
And huh. that's do you know what John Cage used to say when people would say, what's your favorite piece?
Oh,
you can probably
what
guess,
did he
right?
say? Yeah.
What's your favorite piece?
Yeah, did he say the last one?
No, the next
one. The next one, that's right.
It's close,
that's right.
though.
Yeah,
right.
Right.
Close, it's wild.
Yeah. Huh. Do you, did you find, when you were kind of developing your work, did you already have a pretty sort of broad base of understanding and interest in things like mathematics and physics and quantum physics and chaos theory, and, you know, or did you, are those all new spheres that you've explored as you've explored your movement? Do you go, it sounds to me like you want to go after a new vocabulary, or you're curious about a new part of exploring space, and then you'll learn about those things, and you're constantly pushing yourself to learn as you develop a new work. I mean, or did you have a broad base in these more scientific sort of realms before you began?
I was good in mathematics and science.
Right.
That was my kind of avocation. I was really pretty good at them in school. So I was always attracted to mathematics and its abstraction. The
right.
abstractions within mathematics and the pure language of it all really excited me.
Hmm.
And I always used to like to read physics books. I'm not a calculus expert in terms of computation, but I try to theoretically comprehend the different theories.
Right.
And so, no, I think that I really decided, when I got out of college, I met an incredibly erudite man named Philip Gerard, who we felt kind of out of contact. But when I was moving to New York, I asked him for a reading list.
Hmm.
And he gave me this 12-page reading list. And I guess my main thing was always to continue my education.
Right.
And not to, that you can't, college was only about learning how to learn, and
right.
I think that that just comes out of believing that if you're not reading something you don't understand, then you're never going to learn more. And and definitely physics and the chaos theory and the idea that there is no arrow of time, you know, that
right.
the idea of now doesn't exist. It's a pure fabrication of our desire for it to exist.
Hmm.
That we could have a common now
right.
is just a dream, you know.
Mm.
I think humans want to believe there's absolutes.
A construct that people have.
It's kind pure of construct. It's not real. And I think that I like reading about why that is.
Mm.
And also digitalizing movement moments rather than having them exist in a kind of an analog,
mm-hmm.
like fashion,
right.
linear fashion, is really exciting to me. And I think it's towards the nature of time and action. And so reading why that, how that functions in the science of complexity or the superstring theory or the chaos theory, to me, or even trying to understand what's a black hole.
Right.
What does that mean?
You yeah.
know, where does it exist and why? What are those singularities? What are those collapsed universes? I'm not able to go take a test, I don't think, and pass. But it makes me understand when I walk into the studio how to cheat time.
Hmm.
And go to a new place spatially and do the things I need to do to push my work out there.
Right. Would your hope be also that some of the formal basis and that thinking of your work would also start to be, would spark that kind of curiosity in your audiences as well? Or that there would be an understanding of some of the sort of physical property concerns and spatial explorations that you're doing by those who come sort of cold to your work and see it? And
I think I don't have any agenda there.
Uh-huh.
That it's a pretty private
right.
function,
uh-huh.
really.
That it doesn't have to be an educative kind of, it can be strictly, it's okay for audiences to walk away from what they get at their gut level.
Yeah, I mean, you know what I want? I mean, when people say, what do you want from an audience? One, I don't have any agenda or expectation from them.
Right.
That's not my business.
Yeah.
I feel like that's their business.
Right.
My business is to make, I believe if I do my job, the rest of it will happen, which
right.
is to make an effective movement moment.
Uh-huh.
And to me, if I can get people to go like that,
right.
that's the hardest thing to do.
Huh.
And if I can surprise them and be unpredictable and they go away mostly believing that they could do some part of what they saw on stage.
Why is that important?
Because I think that it depends on, like, also I'm thinking very differently as time goes on about what a theatrical experience
uh-huh.
could and should, no should, but could give to an audience. And what audiences, as the century turns, want.
Uh-huh.
And what access they actually have in their worlds. And what this very manufactured, very artificial situation can give to a group of people that live in this world when they have access to anything they want to press a button for.
Right.
In terms of the World Wide Web, in terms of internet, email, CD-ROMs, video, action parks.
Right.
Their world is pretty interactive. And I'm pretty convinced nobody, the mass of people, don't want to just sit and watch.
Right.
So to me, to demonstrate how you have recognition up here on this stage, that you've not either done these things or you know you could do them.
Right.
Even though at the same time, they know how skilled we are.
Right.
And they respect that. Mm. It's not kind of minimalizing that, but it's making them feel like, yes,
right,
I can do that. Rather than, I think, when you go to the ballet, the message is very clear that you cannot do this.
Right.
And it's not that you should be able to do everything. It's just a different message.
Right. It also seems sort of clear that you may not, don't quite have the desire like you'd want to do that. Whereas your work, I see people really wanting to. I see it after I've presented you in the past, kids and people of different ages trying, you know, jumping and trying different things.
Yeah.
Because they feel it in some way. There is that issue of, I mean, many people in the art world bemoan the fact that in the performing arts that somehow they feel that work is needing to condescend in some way or needing to appeal to an entertainment value these days. And that doesn't seem to, you don't worry about that, it seems like. I mean, that because you, I mean, because there are many layers of your work, but do you want to speak to that for a second, or is?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a pretty important issue right now. And a matter of fact, Dance USA just had a conference out in San Francisco on audience development.
Right.
And I think it's a concern in the performing arts world.
Right.
One, because people aren't coming into the theater.
Right.
One. And I don't know how museum attendance is, I'm not sure. But I really believe that in the 20th century, the industry of performance and art has been privatized. And I think it's been co-opted by the upper class.
Right.
And I've recognized that I've participated in that, unbeknownst to myself. Because I think one of the worst faults of liberals is that they think they're liberal.
Right.
And so they don't analyze it. Wait a minute. How do we look to them?
Yeah, right.
I was trying to make an analogy, like when I watch a city kid, you know, the homeboy walk down the street and his pants that go down to his down to his hips look like they're going to fall off, and his shoes that aren't tied. And I'm thinking, okay, now I don't know what that means. I know it means something. Let's see, I'm going to guess. His shoes aren't tied, so that means he's saying to me, I'm so unscared of you, I'm not even going to tie my shoes so I could run away if I were scared of you, because I'm so not scared of you.
Right.
So I'm trying to imagine what I think it's important for us to imagine. What does the outside world think about us and how we look?
Right.
Just the message we're sending. Maybe how our brochures look. And I mean, basically, I don't think the art world invites any but a very, very small segment of this population in. And in terms of worrying about the entertainment problem and how that could mitigate integrity in art, I find that that's really a little bit of a lazy attitude, because I think that entertainment, if you look, I mean, it's not a bad thing. People go to art and performances to be entertained, which means just to be taken away and out of their world.
Right.
And I guess what I believe is that it is kind of a classist issue about what would happen, what would they need to do to invite a larger group of people to the party. And that is exactly what I think way
needs
down deep.
But
needs to happen, I really believe, that art's for everybody.
Right.
And there's something way down deep in a group of people who are either not aware of the fact that they control this or are aware and want to continue to, that they're unwilling to give up.
Right.
Just like with any change, if you're going to really change rather than rearrange the parts, you've got to let something go. And there's parts of this whole thing that they like a lot, and they don't want to let it go.
The exclusivity of it. Oh,
I think so, yeah. And I think, you know, I think audiences would be, maybe if you just took a guess, would they be louder? They'd say things. And the behavior of the audience wouldn't be as constricted.
Right.
There'd be, that's just one small example.
Yeah.
I think the shows would have to start earlier.
Right.
People don't want to take, I hear a lot of people say, I don't want to take my whole evening. So make them shorter, start earlier.
Right.
I mean, the show we're doing in Brooklyn, end of June, is called Out Before Dark.
Oh.
Which means it's over soon. It starts at 7.
Right.
And I'm just trying to experiment with turning it inside out a little.
Right. I think it's great.
Yeah. Well, what do you think? I mean, entertainment in the performing arts, why is that pandering?
No, I don't think it is. I hear it all the time.
People like it. Yeah. I bet
so
you
I
do.
I feel the need to. And I think that, I think that there is certain work that goes for very easy, maybe really easy laughs or easy solutions or things that that a full range of audiences see that as well and leave sometimes unfulfilled because they
sure.
just got sort of a very surface experience of some sort. And there isn't that kind of deeper connection in some way, either emotional or physical. So I think that, I personally gravitate toward work that leaves me with something more.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think people sometimes talk about just entertainment as something that doesn't have greater depth, that leaves you with something to think about and things like that. I mean, that's the sort of... But I've seen a lot of work that would be thrown into the pop culture world and that would be considered in no way, art that totally has that depth. And I see a lot of work that is viewed as art that is sort of doesn't have any resonance.
Yeah.
So it's...
What also a good example is Shakespeare in the 19th century
right.
in this country. I mean, that was incredibly popular entertainment.
Right.
And it doesn't exist in this century, I don't think, for the most part. I mean, wasn't it true that, general people knew words of Shakespeare?
Sure, and right.
Nobody
right.
could possibly people claim him to be
People would laugh and scream
shallow.
And throw stuff up at the actors.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Yeah, in the good old days.
Right.
So to me, that's a perfect example of how it can work, the
right.
interface of art and culture and populism. And I think that the 20th century, it's not happening, but I dream of a world where really high-caliber art can interface with the general public mm-hmm. and not lose its integrity. And I think that's something we have to invent a means to accomplish.
Right. Where would you put someone like Merce in a spectrum like that?
He always gets a...
he gets a bad rap.
Because actually, he really doesn't out at this conference. It was true that people... I think that there is such a thing as a private language.
Right.
And there is nothing wrong intrinsically about that. And I think that gets mistaken, that people think that everybody has to take their language and filter it down to a mass audience.
Right.
Some will not be filtered down to a mass
right.
audience and will require you to acquire a taste and
right.
a developed comprehension of what is happening on stage.
Right.
You will have to do some work.
Right.
And I think Merce is one of those people that the more you understand what it is he's really about architecturally and spatially and temporally, the more deeply you love that work.
Right.
And there is work like that, but not all work is
no.
like that.
And I think there's where the presenter has some obligation in contextualizing work and to bring audiences to it, to meet them halfway, to help them build some sense of the basis of understanding as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, that's why presenters are such visionary, they need to be such visionary eyes and minds, because an audience, if they trust the presenter, they'll come in
right.
to see Stomp and Cunningham.
Right, yeah.
And they will be thrilled, I think, with both.
Right.
I really think that's why the presenter has such a phenomenal job to do.
Right.
And visionary job, and that happens across the country. I mean, look at you in Burlington and Vermont.
Right.
People came from the whole state.
Yeah.
Anything you put on that stage, Philip, they would come and see.
Right.
So it can work.
Yeah. Do you, the work that you're doing here with us, how was it the last 2 days? You performed Bounce in an enormous space. the sense of your discussion about a sense of space. I mean, being in the Metrodome is quite a kind of remarkable experience of just being indoors, but in such an enormous space. How did you feel about that and about the work, the experience of performing was that the first time you've performed in a professional sports arena setting?
While the game was going on.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. We've done basketball courts,
uh-huh.
but made specially for us to perform in.
Uh-huh, right.
But the first time we've been in front of an audience
of
that wasn't there
game.
For us.
Right. And what was your response to it? You performed Bounce, which was about a 6-minute piece.
It's 3 minutes.
Oh, 3 minutes. Wow. Huh.
See, digitalized time.
That's right.
It tricks you.
It does.
Because you get into that time, that relative time frame.
Right.
It was one of the most thrilling experiences of my career, I think.
Oh,
to stand there and look at the movement, and it was up in the jumbotrons, the
right.
images
yeah.
on both sides, and to hear the crowd. Because I really want to know about, you would think I would know about my own language that I've developed.
Right.
But I know only what it means to me, and really a very small converted audience.
Right.
But what does it mean to total strangers that actually want to see a ball game?
Right.
And that's what was so, at every second I listened and felt.
Right.
And I felt like, I was saying that I really find it fascinating that the moves that are most recognizable call the most excitement from the audience. A language that they understand, of course.
Right.
And it made me realize that, oh, you know, you could invent a physical language, not gestural, because to me gestural isn't about moving.
Right.
It's idiosyncratic and not always recognizable. But a language about pure and full physical action that in some connective way is recognized by a large group, most humans.
Right.
And I think that that's an extremely profound experience. You know, and the fact that we don't camouflage gravity has all these metaphoric connotations that I think they were like, oh, wow. You know, and some people say, oh, that's very slapstick. And other people will say, well, I've never heard a human sound that was that intense that didn't imply injury.
Right.
And it was also listening to the sounds that the bodies make because we don't use music and to listen to the reactions of the crowd.
Hmm.
And it was truly, I mean, the piece is only 8 foot square.
Right.
And that ceiling goes up to 168 feet, right?
Right.
And it's over 400 feet long. Huge space. So it was really interesting for me to realize that 8 feet of action focus can get that much response from such a huge crowd.
And the first night I saw it up in the balcony, the second night I saw it from the field, no matter where you were, even though it was a very concentrated amount of space, it really read throughout that building, you know, which was something about both the human ability to concentrate, but also the drama of what you were, you know, of what you were creating there. This weekend we're presenting the company in our sculpture garden with two new works. One is called A Cross, and I wondered if you could talk about that piece. This has been commissioned by the Walker. It's really at this stage a work in progress. And how will that function in your work? What was the origin of that piece, and what will we see this weekend?
A cross is an idea that exists on a 4 by 6 foot surface that's rectangular, and it's on wheels, and it lives on the downstage edge of whatever performing space we're going to be on. Mm-hmm. And it has a rope that goes that way and a rope that goes across the whole length of the stage.
Fastened to the
Nope, there's pullers.
Uh-huh.
The ropes are drawn through a pulley, and there's a puller on each side.
Uh-huh.
So,
but
the,
they're fastened to the wood with the structure.
Uh-huh. To the structure of
yeah.
the board.
Right.
And it's a traverse piece, and it starts stage left, goes all the way to stage right,
uh-huh.
then goes all the way back,
huh.
and then goes all the way back. And it is a work in progress, but I'm not presenting it this weekend like that.
Because right.
what we're showing this weekend is the piece as it lives now.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I don't really believe in works in progress.
Right.
Seems huh. like insulting to the audience to say that. Because,
right.
because I will present a piece.
Right.
They will like it or not. And I'm, my life is in progress, so I,
right.
I just I worry about saying that.
Interesting. Yeah.
But so what it is, in my mind, is a deconstruction of the vocabulary of Ringside. That exists on top, that happens, occurs on top of this constantly moving surface. So what you have with a constantly moving surface is a lot of mini and maxi amounts of turbulence.
Hmm.
Because to establish a vocabulary and a technique on a moving board ups the ante of the execution considerably. And what it does is show the audience who are these performers. Even if they're just trying to freeze a frozen vertical, or they're doing quarter pivots, mm-hmm. or they're doing full rotations, it shows you in isolated form that they'll see as the evening progresses.
Huh.
What are these moves? Why are they hard? What does it mean temporally and spatially and physically? And the attempt of the piece is to, and it goes everywhere from solos to duets to actually four, five people on the board at the same time. And it's going to be in the show that I'm building for 98, interspersed throughout the evening. What we'll see here is 11 passes in part one and 11 passes in part two. But right now, and it'll go across the stage every
time.
When
you say 11 passes, do you mean 11 actual separate movement sequences?
I mean 11, meaning it'll go one time from stage left to stage right. That's one.
Right.
And then it'll go back.
Uh-huh.
And
I
then
see.
It'll go back. And right now I'm putting them all together. Hmm. In the real show, they'll be interspersed. But still the idea is that even though it's a separated dance temporally, it exists as a full dance. It needs to have the integrity of being a full dance, but able to be stopped and seen at different moments throughout the evening.
Right. The movement itself, then, in each of the individual sections is quite different.
Different, yeah. It's different, for instance...
From each other.
Yeah, but each move in Ringside has a name.
Right.
So you'll see, the vertical freeze. You'll see the quarter pivots vertically. You'll see the three-quarter pivots. You'll see the 360. Mm-hmm. Then you'll see the horizontal.
Right.
Quarter pivots, the 180 horizontal, not the 360 because they're pretty hard to do.
Right.
But we're working up to sometimes isolating a technique is harder than doing it. But then they'll see a cross and then they'll see a piece and then they'll recognize parts.
Right. It's almost like when you teach this a few months ago in Burlington, when you were teaching movement class, you're teaching some of those individual pieces to regular movers who came to the,
right.
to the class.
Right, and they were learning the vocabulary from a different departure point, but
right.
one that they could accomplish.
With the new work, Fly, which is the second piece that's being developed, or that we're showing, tell us about that work. I know it's gone through some name changes, but
it will,
right now, at this point in time, in May of 1997, it's called Fly. So
it's called Fly, yeah. I mean, it's true that some people can't name their babies till they've lived with them a while, right?
Yeah.
I'm having that problem with this. It's because it really is so many things. But it was originally an attempt. When I begin a piece, it takes a couple years of devising a concept around usually a spatial premise. The trampoline piece called Up that we're doing here as well out in the garden was just a simple idea. It was about emphasizing the direction up because I noticed it was an underemphasized direction. And that was all there was to it. That was the whole dance. And then it went from there. With Fly, it was noticing the hegemony of the floor, the absolutism of the existence of the floor, and attempting to change that. For some reason or other, that's a much more complicated circumstance, to attempt to believe that as long as the audience or any experiencer of action sees the floor as an absolute, it destroys the attempt to experience action. I've decided that this is the big culprit, the floor. So Fly was an idea that I wanted to simply change the departure point for action and raise it up 15 feet. And it was originally going to be done with bungee cords, which technically
You didn't want to eliminate the floor necessarily, just dispense with it so that the action, the movement could be seen in space alone.
Not that is definitely one of the constructs that I wanted to work with, but not dispense with it, but even out its absolutism by putting another departure point somewhere else.
Right.
So that people would sometimes I feel like if I'm really successful, the audience will be confused about where they are.
Right.
Or affected, at least physically, about where we are spatially.
Right.
And as long as this is a reference point, if you have such absolute reference points, then you're really not going to take the audience anywhere physically.
Right.
They have their focal point, it's the ground. So anyway, my set designer, Bill Ballou, designed this lever system, which is a fulcrum and a bar with a counterweight opposite the end that the body gets attached to. And it, when the body gets attached to this device, it weighs 12 pounds. Hmm. So really, it's called fly because this person can fly. But it's done juxtaposed next to six other bodies that don't have that assistance. Huh. So you have the ground bodies, the ground laden bodies, right, and the air body.
Who are executing some movement, the ground bodies?
They are dancing with the air body.
Uh-huh.
And the other part of this that is so complicated is that it's a frozen radius. So the pathway is a circle. And I've abhorred circles for my whole career, really. Because in abstract terms, to me, it has no beginning and no end and no edge. And the reason to enter it or leave is completely arbitrary.
Right.
Where, at what point do you enter? At what point,
right,
do you leave? And so it's been a very confounding process.
Because the fulcrum naturally would create a circle.
Of a particular diameter that,
right,
doesn't change.
Like a compass would.
Just like a compass.
Right.
So you're dealing with this insistent arc. But the other thing is, because the body can go up 15 feet and come back down again, and it goes up on a curve, it's a spherical outline that's created by this device.
Huh.
And a circle is only the intersection of a sphere. That's all it ever is.
Right.
So it's two-dimensional.
Right.
But watching the operation of the air body versus the ground bodies and the different parabolas that they create juxtapositionally is completely fascinating to me. Hmm. And this dance is about a combination of issues that started out simply by attempting to remove the floor from where it usually exists. And in New York and in the theater, we have a top to this dance.
Uh-huh. I see.
It has a top, which we aren't able to do in the garden this weekend.
Do you use the top, meaning that becomes a sort of inverted ground?
Yes, yes. And I've built one of those in our studio in New York.
Will you do that on stages
as
well?
Yes, yeah. Uh-huh. Because we're going to be able to... We're building a box truss,
uh-huh, right,
that our new show will exist in.
Mm.
And this will be technically all brought with us.
Right.
Not,
yeah.
It could be a theatrical nightmare, technically, but it won't be because we're bringing it with us.
Right.
But anyway, what the dancers have to do that aren't attached to this lever is, and also accumulated momentum we've never really dealt with before. Because a body can accumulate momentum and then it hits the ground or hits another body or a wall.
Yeah.
But this machine, as the dancer is circling, gets faster and faster and faster and creates a sort of turbulent universe, plus this constantly intersecting line in the available space.
The line being the dancer?
The bar.
Oh, the bar itself.
The bar,
right,
that the dancer,
yeah,
is attached,
right,
to forces the other six dancers into spaces they can intermittently just not be in.
Right.
And it's pretty fascinating set of issues. In this dance.
Sounds, I can't wait to see.
I mean, if you are in the wrong place at the wrong time, you have 400 pounds.
Because there's a heavy weight on the other side.
To counterbalance the flying dancer.
And does that circle?
Circles also, yeah. And you've just got to not be there.
Hmm.
So far, luckily, no one's gotten hit. But
right,
it's interesting to realize that space is available, but only every so often. That's a whole nother,
right,
thing. So I think why I'm having trouble naming the dance is as we work on it, and we've worked on it now for a couple months, it keeps manifesting different properties,
right,
from,
sure,
what my original idea was. So,
right,
it's a humbling experience in a,
yeah,
way, because I'll probably end up being able to show what I wanted to show, but all these other things also.
Right. And as the piece develops, you find different properties. So right now it's fly is sort of what it is, but you may find that that doesn't really sum it up.
Yeah,
right.
I might, and I just need to live with it a little longer.
Sure.
And I've written pages and pages of hundreds of different names. I've gotten revolutions, zero gravity. I mean, it's
right.
But after a few days, and working a little longer with the piece, it doesn't resonate any longer.
Right.
So I go on to the next name.
Yeah.
I'm hoping by, in a month, I'll know the name of the dance.
Hmm.
Maybe it'll end up being the dance that was never named.
Untitled one.
Untitled, right.
How do you, your collaborators, like...
Oh,
we are. Okay. We actually only have a few more. How sound does function in your work.
Okay.
And I also wanted to ask you about how you approach the visual design of your work. I mean, how the colors that you choose and the that kind of visual manifestation that you look for in the work.
Okay.
And that was about sort of everything I was...
Great. I love your notes, Phil.
Yeah. Yeah, they're really easy to read. Okay, I think we're...
No, they're not easy to read.
These little scrawls.
Gee, I got my glasses here.
There's a lot of people, obviously, who come to your work from a dance background. The first thing they notice is you don't use music in any traditional sense of it. We were talking earlier about the fact that you feel that each of your works, there is rhythm, and there is a rhythm you create, so they create their own sense of rhythm. But what is your point of view about music? And in fact, the one thing you said earlier that I wanted to get back to was the fact that you felt there isn't a natural connection between the body and its motion in any natural way and what music is and how it creates. And your choice not to have bodies moving to music.
Right. You know, I mean, I think that, you know, I've always, from an early choreographic age, felt that music was the true enemy of dance, that I noticed that happening, that when choreographers would structure movement to sound and have the sound be so ever-present in their performance, that it stripped the power of the action almost in half.
Hmm.
And also I felt that dance skipped this giant step in its own compositional development. Hmm. Like, what's a compositional system that's physically based? And not, I know they're both dependent on time duration, that they're both time-based systems.
Right.
But one is sound.
Right.
And one is action, physical action. And the laws governing both are just different.
Mm.
And the rhythms that can be developed from physical action is just different than the rhythms that you can get out of sound. It's completely a different universe. And so when I was starting to choreograph, and I would use music way back when,
mm-hmm.
I just felt that it was, again, going into an artificial universe. It was manipulating. Mm-hmm. It was coming from my intellect. Oh, gee, I think I'll do an adagio section here.
Right.
I was sort of like, our timing law is you do the move in as much move, in as much time. You do the move in as much time as it takes your body to do that move.
Hmm.
No more, no less. And that requires the body to develop, one, a perfect technique with that particular action, whatever it is. And then it requires you to not use any extra timing because, one, you're tired or not in the mood or you're not skilled enough.
Right.
It does have a goal that is pretty high level in
right.
terms of action and time, physical action and time. And when you put it to what my whole experience of being trained as a dancer was very intellectual, and I couldn't, one, I can't count to music.
Uh-huh.
When the teacher would say, this is a five
right.
phrases, and go 1, 2, 3, 2, 2, 3, I'd count one all the way up to 200. And I'd be like, what do you mean 17 measures?
Right.
It didn't make it. And when I would make phrases, maybe it would be 17 seconds long, and somebody would say, well, why don't you even it up? Or
right.
And I really believe the architecture of sound affects your brain, affects your heart, affects everything. I don't believe we live in a squared off
right.
quarter note world. I know there are different meters in the world.
Yeah, right.
But a lot of them use those squared
right.
off.
Yeah.
And so I just really decided that the timing is an emergent principle. It doesn't happen because you decide, oh, gee, we need a slow section here. It happens because it's integral to the move.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I've built all of my temporal structures.
So in essence, when people, choreographers, you know, work with music, it almost invariably is going to become subservient to they have to follow the music. I mean, it has that sense that that's the sort of driving force, and the movement becomes subsidiary, sort of, in a certain way.
Well, I think sound is very bossy.
Uh-huh.
You know, I think action actually gets people's attention first.
Right.
But in a universe that starts in the morning and goes to evening, Sound is incredibly compelling, and it's hard to fight it.
Right.
The rhythm of sound.
So how do you use sound? Matthew Ostrowski is your sound designer. I mean, really, in some ways, do you consider him where did you find him, and how do you use his work? It seems it emanates from the movement rather than the opposite.
Yeah. Well, he originally, I mean, we had a lot of battles about what his title was. Uh-huh. And now he's called Composer-in-Residence.
Okay.
I called him Interactive Sound Designer for a long time. For me, what it is about, I want the audience to hear the moves we make. That's a very important part of noticing the large spectrum of the information from the action.
Right.
Even in the Metrodome, the sound was the only way that action read in that huge space.
Right.
You need to hear the sound of the movement.
Right.
When I'm in a normal theater watching dance, I feel like somebody's covering one of my senses because the sound is on, the music is on, and I can't hear the moves being made. I feel like that's wrong somehow. And I have this aspiration that in 50 years, everyone will agree with me. That dance shouldn't go to, or maybe there'll be a whole other field devised called action.
Right.
You know, I don't know. But what Matty does is he designs microphones and plants them in strategic locations. And he has a fairly complex system of computer-generated samplings for some of the pieces, not all of them. And also he puts them through a slightly delayed system before it gets played back. And to me, that's just to thicken the effect a little, to dimensionalize and theatricalize the sound.
Right.
But the idea is the rhythms are still mine, that
the
rhythms are the action of the dance, the integrity of the dance.
Right.
And that he really plays the board like a one-man band. Hmm. We're the instrument, and he's playing the board, you know, while the show is going on.
In some ways, I mean, I see, again, you've taken it a whole nother place, but a connection with Merce and how much flack he got about the fact that his movement didn't necessarily, it coexisted with the sound, but it didn't necessarily, wasn't created to follow the sound, really. And
right, he's probably the other singular example of not using music in that way.
Right.
And I think one of the reasons his structures are so complex and really unrecognizable, I really believe that most dance people only recognize structure if it's musical. And if it's not, they'll say there's no structure. Or they'll say everything repeats. This is what I notice in the reviews that get written.
Huh.
I never repeat anything, because I don't do that A, B, A, C.
Right.
Theme, motif, etc. I don't do that. So I'm always kind of, I always have a smile on my face when it goes, it's very repetitive. I'm like, what's repeating? But also it's interesting that if it's a good structure in the eyes of the world is a recognizable structure. And that often a structure that's maybe modeled after, you know, for me, a more visual arts kind of context isn't recognized, or an architectural kind of context. For me, it's a physically based system that needs a structure of physical issues.
Right.
Just like I've said a few times that time has never held a building together, nor would anyone expect it to. So why should sound hold an action piece together?
It's an interesting analogy.
I know most people kind of go, what is that? I'm still working on that. Right? Some of those.
No, I get that. The visual look of your work, the use of really bright and primary colors, and the kind of, you walk into a Streb performance and you immediately feel there's a different feel to the space, the way even the space is lit up and the stage is lit up and the colors of the mats that you've chosen and things. Tell us about that.
Okay, I want to also mention Heather Carson, who's our lighting designer and has been for 13 years, and she's a very, very big part of my conceptual process. We've kind of artistically grown together over that time period. And she has independent light sources that are structural and architectural. They don't really pander to lighting bodies. That's not what they're about. And we've gotten certain amount of flack about lights and eyes and that kind of thing, bright white lights. And she really believes in energizing the ions in the air with her lights. And to me, that's a whole nother physical presence that makes our show be as vibrant as it is.
Right.
And the reason for primary colors, I mean, to me, there are only three colors in the world. And everything else is just a lack of decision-making ability on everyone's part. I mean, pink, white, or red, decide. You know, it's like, to me, adding colors away from those three primaries is a decorative effect. And I mean, it really happened out of my gut. Like, when I would put a green costume on, I think, well, no. You know, decide, red, blue, yellow, you know. And I think that... for me also, when the colors get juxtaposed, it's really a physical feeling. They really oscillate against one another.
The primary colors.
The primary colors, and they're very, very powerful.
Right.
And to me, it really is just that, you know. And also deciding visually how they jump around and how you juxtapose and carve out the edges of the space. Because structurally, I really work pretty rigidly with frame of reference and how that instigates the perception of our work. Hmm. How that's the starting off point with my body is 6 feet tall at the most bodies. And if I have an 8 foot square, I'll be able to create on that palette an effective movement moment. Hmm. If I deal with the proscenium that I usually walk into, which is 30 by 30, I in a 6 foot body, I can't do anything effectively to that space. And also angle of viewing. That the visual arts is able to really have a huge handle on because they're working with visual properties, and especially in painting, you know, they have complete control over angle of viewing.
Right.
For me, you know, I need to decide and take into consideration how the audience is viewing my work. And I really deconstruct, decipher, and re-angle a lot of those decisions based on the angle of viewing. Process. And also the third thing is frame of reference. Not frame of reference, but reference point. Like, what is a reference point for our work? Is it static corners in a room, or is it the body itself? And to me, it's the body itself. That's the only thing that is constant in action. And you shouldn't use a static universe to reference action, which ballet has done for the most part. So those properties help me to design my picture, basically.
Right. I also remember, this is back to your point about most audiences don't want to just sit and view your work at times, that even when we last worked together in Burlington, you make a point to come out and talk with people about their responses to the work or questions. You even had people stand and move a little bit themselves to get those cells working, and do you find what have you found that does for connecting your work to audiences in terms of, I mean, it allows people to have certainly a relationship with you as the creator. I mean, an individual. This is the person who's done this and created this work. But.
Right. I mean, I think I believe in the we now, over the last 4 years, open all our rehearsals, even in New York, to the public.
Right.
And I try and make that announcement everywhere we go. So people, like often strangers coming by where we work, just show up.
And we did that even here this week. We had an open rehearsal.
We had open rehearsals over at the gymnasium.
Yeah.
And where we work in New York, it has a garage door.
Right.
So we just throw it open on nice days, and everybody and their brother come in there to watch what we do. And that goes along with the... at the end of every show, I come out into the stage and turn the house lights up, and so do all my dancers come out into the stage.
Right.
And I want to find out what happened.
Right.
And it's information gathering to me. I'm interested, and what I try and do is make
people... So it really is for you as much also. I mean, it's not just to get it across to the audiences in any way.
No, they already know.
Right.
I don't really believe that there's something they don't know.
Right.
I really believe that if people get it, it's to be gotten.
Right.
And it's not their problem if they don't get it.
So it's a sort of R&D for you in a certain way.
Completely, yeah. Uh-huh. And what I try and do with the action thing is to, because I really believe people want to do it.
Yeah.
So I want to give them a little experience of it.
Right.
And also to relax them enough for them to give me critical feedback,
uh-huh.
which is actually incredibly hard in a formal environment to get.
Right.
And I need that. I need to know what you didn't like. I mean, sometimes we've had audiences screaming at us.
Right.
Usually they're pretty polite. But some people get mad about the sound. Some people believe it's violent. Some people don't like the lights in their eyes.
Yeah.
And I'm able to go out there and acquire information from strangers,
right.
which to me is why when artists are young, they're so diligent and rigorous often, in the early part of their career, because you're mostly performing for strangers.
Right.
You don't have friends out there.
And you need that tough skin in a certain way. And
I think you need the truth. And I think people give strangers the truth sometimes way more than they do people they're familiar with, or there's an agenda involved around a very complicated business as we go forward in our career.
Right.
And I don't feel like in New York I'll ever get the truth out of anyone in my audience there. Huh. I have my followers and people who hate it and people are in the middle.
Right.
But I want to know what doesn't read for you here? What do you wonder about? And so that's how I'm able to, like, really believing that my artistic decisions will be shaped by who, the eyes that watch what I do.
Hmm.
And feeling very attached and reverent about that.
Right.
That is, it's a performing art. And it's not unless there's eyes watching it.
Right.
And sometimes the purest eyes are those who've never seen it before.
Sure.
And don't care about me and don't know me.
Right. And aren't impressed by your stature or are willing to sort of tell you exactly what they think or whatever.
And most people, I mean, in New York, modern dance, I mean, in America, people, they don't know.
Yeah,
they come to the show because of the theater.
Right.
And there's a few people who know who we are.
Right.
But mostly they don't, you know. I'm a stranger to them.
Right.
And I like that. I like that. I love the Metrodome because they were like, they don't care. It doesn't matter who it is.
Right. Right.
Like, you could go ahead and say, well, I'm an important person, and they'll say, well...
Yeah, I'm having my hot dog in,
I mean, also, Michael Jordan's an important person.
Yeah.
But what are you doing out there?
Right.
And if you could, we can focus on what's the thing, what's the action as a subject. And if it doesn't work, then nothing after that's going to work.
Right. Yeah, I was pleased to see, I guess this is my last... final question for you, but that you had, you've been quoted as saying that you're not at all, or you're not depressed by the climate for artists, that you're in fact inspired by it in a certain way, and that, do you have, are you hopeful about the future for the arts, but in your work in general, and where do you see your work going from here? It sounds like there's unlimited possibilities of space and temporal and other exploration that you can continue to explore. Is that your sense?
Do you mean my work going artistically or just real world?
But there was really two questions. The first is being sort of in the real world and the second being artistically.
I feel like, you know, cultures and eras have waves, and I see this as reality. There's a bit of a cap on the funding market.
Right.
I think we need to, that means we need to spread it out a little.
Right.
And if people were really devoted and interested and they felt that art affected their lives, I think that there'd be a lot more funding.
Right.
You know, they would fight all of these funding caps. I think that falls on our lap. I think that's my job to figure out how to get into the real world.
Right.
That I have not been affecting the real world enough. And I want to go there, like go to malls, like the Mall of America here.
That'll be our next project.
Yay! Well, that's why we're building this box truss, because it can go anywhere.
Right.
And it, you know, it's great for theaters because they don't have a lot of pre-work to do.
Right.
And it's great for malls or parks. And
right.
So we're really thinking entrepreneurially about where will performance happen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the question of where.
Right.
And not necessarily in theaters.
Right.
But also in theaters. And then in terms of my work, there's infinity. And I think that that just is a given. And I really think that there's so much more ground to cover. And I've been incredibly privileged to, in a way, in the dance world, slip between the cracks enough so that I feel incredibly well supported there.
Right.
I'm not feeling really, even though there is a funding crunch, I'm not feeling it because I feel like it forces us to invent new ways.
Right.
And I don't, in the not-for-profit structure that I've existed in, I don't really believe in having an organization built around a single person's ideas.
Hmm.
And it's allowed me, this breakdown has allowed me to just throw all that out. I don't really believe I should have a board of directors.
Hmm.
You know, I'm not an organization, I'm not an institution.
Right.
It's just not realistic. So I've been able to say, you know, oh good, I don't have to do that anymore. And pare down and outsource, and look for new ways to function in the real world. And I think that I really do believe that the harder it gets, the more I like it. Isn't there some kind of sports expression, like, you know, it's kind of like
you got to sacrifice in order for it to really be worthwhile in a certain way.
Yeah, to notice any difference. You know, you have to really, like, it needs to be invented every time. I don't want to, because what happens when new systems become classical is that they sort of die in a certain way. Hmm. And for a temporal art form, I think it's crucial that I figure out how to make it be real. I don't think dance has figured out its perfect format yet.
Right.
I don't think it's figured out how to encase itself as a product or as an entity so that it economically can exist in a realistic way, but also that it can be honest with itself about its own nature.
Right.
And I'm interested in figuring out, well, what would that encasement look like?
Hmm. Well, thanks a lot for taking the time.
You're welcome. My pleasure.